Welcome to a new test and teardown video. This time it's a DIY project. An 80 meter receiver, completely DIY. It even says here, made by OZ7MA in 1996 to 97. So he spent a year on making this one. So OZ7MA is called Arne. He's an electronic engineer. He's been very active already from the 1950s, making articles in the local radio amateur magazines. He's more than 90 years old and still going strong. So he's cleaning up a little bit on all on some of the older projects. And this is why I got this receiver, and I actually also got the transmitter. So tomorrow we're going to look at the transmitter as well. But today we're going to focus on this really nice receiver, and hopefully it still works. There's a cable that goes to the transmitter. There's a DIN connector here, and it says here mute. So this will be, of course, for RX-TX switching. And of course, when you're transmitting, the transmitter will control the receiver and turn the receiver silent. It even says here, so if you need to use the receiver alone, then you should connect this connector here on the mute. So this is just super, super genius way to do it, right? So this way you will enable the receiver to work, right? And then there's a mains power cord, so I could just power this up and see if it works or not. I really like the way that we got some different bands indicated by some LEDs here. So I expect this switch to be the different. Oh, that is a, this is a preamp. Oh, so you adjust the preamp for the different frequencies. I was expecting this to be a switch that kind of selected those. Or maybe it's done automatically. I don't know. I don't know yet. Monitor or mute. Got some attenuator. ATC fast or slow. So it can do LSB, CB or USB. Oh, this seems to be a pod. How can that be a pod? I was expecting a switch here. So that's a little bit interesting how that is working. Let's look at the rear. Let's see all the switches or the connectors. So that will be the mute input, antenna input, loudspeaker, so it can run off 15 volts external. No, it says 16 volts. Maybe this is, I don't know what that is actually. And then we got the mains cord. It's going to be interesting to see if there's any action going on in this one. And I can't wait to open, oh, it's really heavy. Can't wait to open this and see what is inside. That's gonna be interesting. So stay tuned. I've already been powering this unit on after doing a little bit of tests, as you can hear. It seems to be alive. Let's just crank down the volume here while we are playing a little bit with the tuning. If I remove the light, maybe you can, yeah, now you can see the LED a little bit better, right? So look at that. Isn't that cool? So when you turn the dial, then the LEDs for 3.5, 3.6, 3.7 and so on, it goes on so you know what range you're in. And blah, blah, blah. I was expecting this to happen at exactly that point, right? So I wonder how that is made. Maybe a frequency counter of the VFO? That is actually pretty cool for a homebrew project. So this is 3.6, right? And then I go doink. That should be 3.700, more or less, right? So what I've done is I take my signal generator and I say 3.7 megahertz. And then let's crank up the volume. See? We can. So I guess this will be the BFO, where you input to the secondary mixer in this way. See? By changing that frequency, you can do LSB, CV, or USB. Alright, so if I have it in CV, I should get a tone. So, will you hear? You hear the noise? It's going up. You can even turn on the preamp if you want, then it goes. And then there's of course feedback and manual or automatic gain control. So you can turn this on and off. And we can change the gain control fast and slow and all that kind of stuff. So, now I got some input and I can try all the... Every time you hear a beep, 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 beep. This is 3.6 input and then I hear the highest. So no matter what I do with input, I don't hear a tone. And I've tried to crank up the input like real bad and mean, and this doesn't help at all. So there's, let's do that, okay? So there's no sensitivity at all, or there is an oscillator that is not working, or a mixer or something that is not working. So definitely, just too bad, this receiver is not working, and there is no cal either. So that means if you hit the cal, the idea is that you should get a peak every 100 kilohertz. And this way you can calibrate here, and then you hear a whoop, whoop, and then, now I know where it is and all that kind of stuff. So this is normal for VFO radios to have this feature. The filter here works, so it's narrow or wide for SSB or for CV. So that seems to be working. You can hear the difference. Now it's a narrow band, a wide band. It's that effective this is actually the signal gain you get by using Morse code, because you are using a very, very narrow band. And this way you get no noise, but you get the wanted signal in. So that is why Morse code wins, because the bandwidth is super, super small. So we can't do a lot more than just open this and have a look what is inside this fantastic unit. So now we are inside. That is definitely nice. Nice, nice homebrew. Oh, that is a big crystal. Oh, we got some more sockets for other crystals, I guess. Like that, right? The VFO is from something else, right? SPR4. 4.9 to 5.5 VFO, it says. And then there's this nice bulb. Look at that. What is that wire doing? Oh! What? What the heck? Okay, let me get closer. You're gonna see this in a second. That is so cool. Now I know how this LED. Now I know how the four LEDs work. Oh, I have to move the camera. Here we go for a nicer close up. Look at that. So when I move the dial, can you see what happens? Now the LEDs are updated with this. So this is a contact. And that is of course the spring for the voltage to the contacts. How nice is that? I did not expect to see a mechanical solution. Wow, I really, really love it when I open stuff and find all sorts of cool surprises. Yeah, that is just fantastic. And both of the boxes here is in nice shielded boxes. Got a production detector, IF1 beat oscillator, feedback output, preamp out. There'll be some shielded cables here. All in all, it's not that bad. What about that board over there? Is that a homebrew kind of stuff, or is it stolen from something else? Is it possible to take off the sides so we can see more? So now we are all the way out of the cabinet and we can now enjoy a lot more of this. I think I've seen this type of a mains transformer before from like tape recorders. So that is also reused. And that is reused. And that board over here is homebrew something. See some nice little values here. Written on capacitors, so that is something with the VFO. And that board is also homemade. And this is the bottom of the unit. It is actually quite nice. Double layer PCBs. And the top here is ground for good shielding. Ground plane for the PCBs. That is really, really nice. Then you drill out all the signals, all the holes like this, and then you solder the ones that is connected to ground, and this way your ground plane is really good. So this is not a good, or this is not a bad idea, really. That fuse is a little bit corroded, and that is actually very normal for fuses, this type of metal. They are made from is always corroding. Some kind of a zinc alloy that is always bad. Some old diodes. It's really hard to date this unit other than the information we got from the front. So we already got a perfectly good dating. It says 86, 87, because it is made using reused parts, because back in the old days radio amateurs always tried to save every little penny they could. So reusing parts, that is definitely what radio amateurs would do. So when you look at date codes for ICs and transistors, you're going to find them a lot older than that. And here we got the two quartz filters. They look like they are new, or they were like purchased for this project. So that would probably be quite expensive. Yeah. So yeah, I think we should go and have a look. Oh, well that hurt. Let's go and look inside that box. It looks like we got a PCB in the middle and then you access from both sides. So how do we access in here? That means we need to totally dissect the whole thing, and that is not what I wanted to do, because I want to keep this as original as possible and I don't want to create any kind of problems for this really, really nice unit. So that will be inside the BFO. It's called beat frequency oscillator. And this is the oscillator you mix your VFO with, and then you create audio. And so this needs to be really, really accurate. And I actually wanted to show you something. Look here at the front. There's a tiny little hole where it says BFO. And that hole goes to that inductor. And here's the top lid of the unit. This one says for BFO. I mean, how cool is that? I love it. Someone, yeah, we'll know this was Arne. Arne spent many, many hours having fun making this unit. Look at all those hours of fun. That is just so nice. See those holes? They're made so you can access the screws. Isn't that cute? Easy, easy. So if you liked this, the receiver, please stay tuned for the next video, the transmitter. Of course, we're gonna go and have a look inside the transmitter and see what that can do and how that is made. I really like to see somebody had a lot of fun